Good evening and welcome to tonight's school board meeting, June 9th, 2015. I can't believe it's that time. Would you please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance? Thank you for joining us this evening. Our first item on the agenda is to ask if there are any adjustments to tonight's agenda. Seeing none, we're moving right along. On to item two, approval of the school board minutes. May I have a motion?
Sure. I move that we approve the school board minutes from each of the meetings laid out in our agenda.
Second. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Our third item on the agenda this evening is comments from our student representatives. I do know that we're longer of our senior.
Yes, Sierra is a graduate. Natalie, a graduate of Cape Elizabeth High School, and Natalie let me know that she had a work commitment this evening and would be unable to.
I hope she can get out and enjoy the evening. Item number four, are there comments from the public on agenda items? Seeing none. On to the item number five, communications. I do believe we have a special guest this evening. We have the Pond Cove Principal of the Day. Kelly, would you care to introduce?
Thank you so much.
Elizabeth, feel free to come.
Doing a little check thing.
Whatever you want.
For the people at home. You just have to speak so that we can hear you.
Okay. So I want to introduce Principal Declan Seifries, who took over my job today. He doesn't really have to go to college. I've told his mother she can save a lot of money. His parents can save a lot of money because he is all ready to take over. So he is all set. So he's going to give you an overview of his day, and then he's going to share with you. It's okay. He's going to share with you a PowerPoint of our 250th projects, that 250th anniversary projects that the whole school's been doing. So, ready to take it away?
Good evening, members of the school board. My name is Declan Seifries, and I was principal for the day at Pond Cove School. I had a lot of fun. My rules for the day, teachers could give their classes an extra recess sometime this week if their students followed expectations. I also allowed kids to chew gum at school today. I also allowed kids to wear hats and sunglasses at school today. I asked all kids to try to make a new friend today. I asked kids to leave a nice secret note for their teacher on the teacher's desk when they were not looking and see if the teachers could guess who it was from. I did the morning announcements today and announced what was for lunch, birthdays today, and what the rules would be. I let people in by using the school security buzzer. I had to ask them who they were before I could let them in. I also got to wear Ms. Hassan's security card that gave me a lot of power to get in and out secure places. I have lunch duty and made sure kids followed expectations. Ms. Hassan took me to the Ocean House of Pizza for lunch, and I got to bring my friend Nathan with us. I also got to do bus dismissal. Ms. Hassan and I walked around the school to make sure everything was going well. I get another half day as principal because we couldn't do a few other things because Ms. Hassan had to do some extra work. I can't wait.
Do you want to remove the thing?
Declan got permission from Facilities Director Marles to remove the yes, so he could see it better.
He thought of everything.
That's a lot of power right there to be removing the seal.
Palm Coast Schools interdisciplinary learning in honor of Cape Elizabeth's 250th anniversary. Kindergarten's 250th birthday cake. First graders explore Kettle Cove tidal pool life with marine and duck educator Carol Stungart. First grade multimedia tidal pool. Pond Cove headlight created by first graders. Second grade ink prints for Cape Elizabeth poetry books. So how this is made is with somebody named John Holdridge. We started by taking photos different places in Cape Elizabeth, and then we would pick a photo that we wanted and then print it. And we'd make a small frame made out of pencil on the photo of what we wanted to show of the picture. And then we cut out that part of the photo very carefully with an adult, and we traced onto styrofoam with the paper, and then the paper was the scraps. And we used the ink. We used ink and the styrofoam as a printing block. Then we used a piece of paper once we inked the styrofoam very carefully, and we pressed it down on a piece of paper, and out came the print. Principal Seyfried's ink print book cover of Spurwink Church.
It's beautiful. Oh, it's gorgeous.
Poem written by Principal Seyfried's where his parents were married. Okay. Now I will read the poem. Spurling Church. Workers are mowing the grass in the graveyard. Boy and girl are marrying in the church. Worshippers are rejoicing in the sanctuary, by Declan S. Third grader painting, Cape Farm mural. Stories of the Cape mural installed in Pond Cove entryway and created by the third grade. John Benoit Samuelson near one of her favorite places to run when she was growing up. Fort Williams. Cape School is a long time ago. Fourth grade physical theater depicting the foghorn at Portland Headlight. Boiling lobster at the old Kettle Cove Inn. So there's this guy, the guy who's standing up straight took another kid in the act that showed like the whole school what they were doing, and he put him over the shoulder of, and then he carried him and threw him in the pot. Surfing Cape Elizabeth, USA.
And we wanted to give special thanks to the generous grants from the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation, the Pond Cove Parents Association, and their donors. Bonus thanks to Pond Cove K-4 students, Pond Cove K-4 teachers, Mary Jane Johnston, Pond Cove art teacher, Cameron Rosenblum, Pond Cove media specialist, Pond Cove custodians, middle school teacher Steve Price, Gretchen Berg, physical theater artist, Lori Downey, graphic and visual artist, Sarah Herbelsheimer, graphic and visual artist, John Holdridge, literacy and arts teacher, Carol Steingart, marine educator, Cape Elizabeth Historical Preservation Society, and the Cape Elizabeth 250th anniversary.
Does anyone have any questions for our principal of the day?
I do. Declan, so you and I have been in a number of school board meetings together, so you're no stranger to school board meetings, and now you've been principal for a day. That's a lot of experience for a man of your age. Do you think you'd be interested in a career in education? Would you like to be a teacher or a principal?
I was actually thinking about being a dentist.
Another good choice.
Kind of feels the same too.
Maybe all that experience leads you toward wanting to be a dentist, I guess. There might be some sympathizers in the room.
I think it was something about like pulling teeth.
last Wednesday, my class was gardening out in the Mrs. Spadinger's raised bed, and there are 10 extra minutes of free play time on a half of the playground called Natureland, and I was playing with some other people doing boys chase girls. And somebody in my class was chasing me, and she was a girl. And I tripped over a rock and hit my mouth on a rock and cracked my front tooth.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I got it filled in, and I'm going back in about 7 years to get a different type of filling. that's stronger, but not stronger.
You are acquiring some great firsthand dental experience then. You are going to be well prepared for a career in dentistry, Declan.
And you also cut below my thumb and cut my lip.
So I have a question for you, Declan. So I was wondering if you could tell me how you became the principal for the day.
So in March, there was beach bingo raffle where you entered raffle tickets and you can still win a prize even if you're not there, and I was not there. And on Facebook, when I was in the middle of watching a movie called Big Hero 6, my dad was like, Declan, come in here. And on Facebook, somebody had posted that I had won the principal of the day. I was like,
it's exciting.
That's really the one I wanted most.
I have one question.
Yeah?
So you're anxious for another half day. What else do you hope to accomplish?
I'm looking to accomplish a secret dance party.
Oh.
And a fire drill.
And a fire drill.
And Miss Hassan has a secret for me. Because Miss Hassan had some extra work, so that's why.
I thought your idea about secret notes to teachers was a wonderful idea.
Yeah.
Without names on it, I love that idea. So they had to guess who wrote.
I'm really wondering who wrote the note in my class.
Was it a good note?
Yes.
I have one other question since my daughter's in your class. Was it different being in school and being the principal? Was it the same, or did you feel like you were getting special treatment, or were you not in the classroom at all as principal of the day?
I went with my class across the street to it's on this side of the street, but across the street from the school to the land trust building. And I was glad I went, but then I came back and went down to the office. Well, I didn't really go to Chewonky. I just went to the land trust building. People from Chewonky came there. But they brought a live animal it can be found here, but that one was 3 times bigger than the stick bugs that you would find here. Just from the rainforest. And then they brought a bearded dragon from the desert. And I think it was like a wet winged owl. They're small, but they're not as small as an owl that lives in a cactus.
Interesting. Wow.
So I have left the office, but I only went into my classroom to pick up my folder and put it away and get my backpack and put it in my locker. So,
So Declan, if you run out of work at Pond Cove, have Miss Hassan give me a call and we'll definitely find some for you over here. There's plenty to go around.
Thank you.
Thank you, Declan.
Nice work.
Well done.
He really can fill in any time. He's really, as you can see, quite skilled and looking forward to another half day. And Declan, thank you. You did a fabulous job, or I should say Principal Cyphers. You're still officially Principal Cyphers.
What a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Kelly, I would just say while you're looking at these pictures too, I went in just because I've been following the mural a lot. I went in to watch the children arrive yesterday. I know Kelly and the artist put a whole bunch of time in this weekend to get that up. Looks fabulous. And watching the kids come in and brush and point to the things that they had done and show each other was really very exciting.
That's really fun.
Yeah, it was just, it's a great exhibit. Thank you.
Okay. Moving on, item 5B, recognitions.
So I believe, and I don't know if Hassan wants to stay up there to introduce her, but with us from Pond Cove, as mentioned last month, is an art essay award winner, Annemieke Butterbaugh. I'm sorry, I had it right before and I almost fouled it up, but she's going to share her essay with us. And we want to thank her mom and her sister for being here to support her as well.
We just have so much talent at Pond Cove. We're just gonna monopolize the night, so just sit back, okay? Sorry, middle school and high school. So, Mickey, you want to share?
I think she has some pictures she's going to share with us, too.
Do you want me to read the essay now?
That would be great.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Well, or do you want to tell people first just a little bit what the reason you wrote the essay was?
Well, first, our art teacher actually asked us to do it because we were staying in for our recesses a lot to help her out with the kindergartners. So she just asked us to do it. I think it was because there was graffiti in the bathroom last year, and so we thought that if there was like art in there, maybe people would not do graffiti in it.
So Annemieke and her classmates, who she's going to share with you, created a mural at Pond Cove. I'm just going to tell you about that.
Okay. I'll read the essay. Not too long ago, my friend and I painted a mural of a Zentangle tree in our school bathroom to try to prevent graffiti from entering our bathroom as it had the past year. We thought that if there was to be a piece of art in the bathroom, it may encourage students not to write churlish things on the walls, but maybe instead it would prevent. I hadn't known then when I was starting that it would really make an impression on people, but now I do. When we were just starting out with our mural, people did not seem to think highly of it, other than their drawing on the wall. But over a course of time, people really started to notice it. They started to ask questions and make positive comments, and well, we would give them answers. No one really knew what it was going to look like in the end, but no matter what, we all knew it was going to turn out marvelous. A couple of times, my friend and I would stay after school working on it, and a couple of times early in the morning before school started. We also spared a lot of our recess times working on it. It was work, but hard work is the only type of work, so we made the best of it. One time, we invited some of our other younger friends to come help assist us so they could feel pride in it, so that next year when they are in our grade, they might stand up against the cause of people making graffiti on it. Over time, since we started with our rough draft and pencil, we not only noticed, but everyone around me seemed to notice that the mural was starting to evolve and come to life. While working on it, I realized that the mood in the bathroom was starting to change. When people came in, they would kneel down on the floor and look up, feeling like they were a part of the tree, spreading their branches out for everyone to see them. And I think that helped people get through things, seeing a bright, happy tree in the middle of a bathroom. It also taught people how to smile. Nothing more, nothing less, just a smile.
That's great. Wow. Thank you.
So, Annemieke, can you tell us anything about the contest that your essay won for?
Well, our art teacher, Mary Jane Johnston, she actually told us about the contest, if we wanted to do it or not. And for some reason, I decided to do it in the last week before it was due. I don't know why. I guess I just forgot about it. And I was like, okay, I'm just going to do this, you know. I'm probably not going to win, and it'll be fun. And so I did it. And then about a week or two later, my mom got an email saying that I had won. And I was very astonished because I just did it at the last minute. I like finished it the night before it was due. So I didn't really expect to win. It was very happy and overwhelming.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's beautiful. Really beautiful.
Really?
People
probably
think about it. It's a beautiful work.
Thank you.
Really, it's beautiful.
Makes me smile to look at.
So, wow.
Thank you.
And what a great thing to leave behind for future students at Pond Cove, including your sister.
And we're right now, me and my friend Amy Brasco, we are doing a mural outside of our technology teacher's office because he wants it jazzed up a little bit.
That's awesome.
It's beautiful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have two more.
We have two more legislative sentiments. I won't read them all, but Senator Millett was unable to join us, and actually the awardees are also not here. But just to share with you, we're recognizing two students, high school valedictorian Lily Jordan, who just graduated on Sunday, is being recognized by the legislature for winning the National American Voices Award for the Scholastic Art and Writing Awards. Named the most prestigious Young Writers Recognition Program in the United States for her humor piece On Our Honor. And Lily received a Gold Key Award and nomination to the National American Voices Award regionally for another piece called, for her piece On Our Honor, and also received a Silver Key Award for another piece. So congratulations to Lily.
Congratulations to Lily. And
Will Steidel is also being recognized by the legislature and will also receive a Gold Key Award and is a Regional American Voices nominee for his National Scholastic Art and Writing, for the National Scholastic Art and Writing Awards for his essay, Injustice and Discrimination Against Women in Saudi Arabia. And so again, congratulations to Will.
Great.
And we will ask Principal Shedd to help them receive these awards.
I'll never forget Lily Jordan as a middle schooler coming into this room and reading to us her essay on why there should not be homework. And it's a good thing for board members to recognize as she graduates valedictorian and an award winner that was the position she took in middle school.
And for a girl who didn't want homework, she also won the hearts and minds, I think, of the entire region at the National Spelling Bee. As an eighth grader, where I remember even in my office, people were stopping and running down the hall, Lily's up again. And as I hear tell, the entire middle school would just erupt into screams of joy when she spelled another word correctly. So she's really done a number on our district. It's pretty special. Are there more?
That is it.
That is it?
Well, that portion.
That portion. Okay, thank you very much. That's really fun. And then we have item 5C, the annual report of volunteer services from Gail Schmader. You don't want to stand on the stool?
Well, I have two very tough acts to follow. I'll do my best.
You will do.
It's been a great year. Over 1,000 volunteers supported our 1,650 students in all aspects of their education. These volunteers gave the school the equivalent of $320,000 through approximately 21,000 hours of service, the equivalent of 16 staff positions. These figures don't include the many hours of volunteer support from the Parents Association, extracurricular, and booster club activities. So that would put the number well, well over 1,000. The community donated over $8,000 worth of tangible resources, not including the many classroom supplies that were donated on a weekly basis. Donated resources ranged from large donations of Legos and board games for indoor recess at Pond Cove, we had a lot of those this winter, to metal puzzles and small toy cars for middle school science experiments, to sets of golf clubs for the high school phys ed program. The most donated item continued to be tennis balls, used to quiet student chair and desk legs to protect the floors at Pond Cove and the middle school. Small things really do make a difference. There was very strong support, volunteer support for many different school projects. A senior community volunteer supported the high school physics program for the seventh year. Physics teacher, Dr. Michael Efren, comments, "I've had an amazing volunteer all year. As in previous years, he comes in 3 days out of the high school's 4-day rotation. He is presently tutoring 21 students from physics classes. I have come to depend on his assistance. There is one student who he has tutored all year, who has gone from being one of the neediest in the class to the highest grade on the last test. The volunteer is terrific.
And happens to be sitting in our audience. I just want to acknowledge Bill for that.
Bill Gross, congratulations. How appropriate. Thank you so much for your service. You have truly made a difference. Thanks. And the students, I'm sure, thank you. Student literacy was especially well supported. Two senior community members patiently and quietly met with several individual first grade students each week to support their literacy development. One volunteered 3 times a week with her student, and she states, "Reading opens the world for someone. I like giving any help I can to make reading easier for the children. I enjoy opening up possibilities for them." And she plans to continue with the same students if they're needed in the second grade. Volunteers were critical for the success of middle school week-long hands-on writing workshop directed by the Telling Room staff in the fall. They were also critical for the resounding success of CAPE Celebrates Literacy Week in the spring. Many parent and community members, which we just saw the results of, helped make Pond Cove 250th celebration a stunning work of art on many levels. Each project was based on authentic research. 35 high school mentors provided support for Pond Cove and middle school students. Mentors connect with students who are experiencing some type of challenge, academic or social-emotional, or students who just need a friend. Many times, the weekly mentor connection is the highlight of a week for the student. A mentor comments, "I could definitely see progression in his friendship with people, constantly saying hi to just about everyone who walked by." A mentee comments, "I can't wait to see my mentor every week. I try to do better schoolwork to impress him. On a scale of 1 to 10, my mentor is an 11. And a teacher comments to her student's mentor, "You've done such a good job mentoring that he's ready to spend his lunch and recess with his friends." Mentors gained as much as their mentees. A parent, mother of 3 mentors, states, "Without exception, my children have immensely benefited from their experience. They have grown as individuals, developed kindness and empathy, learned the importance of confidentiality and the value of individual differences, and gained self-confidence." Heartfelt thanks to all the school volunteers. What a difference they make. It only takes one. One person, one unexpected possibility, one ordinary moment of insight to create a life-changing experience taken from "Because You Believed in Me." It's been an honor and a privilege to work with each volunteer and staff member. I've had a grand time. Thank you for this incredible opportunity to serve our community. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Thank you so much for everything.
Thanks.
Well, that actually is a nice segue.
It's a perfect segue.
Bittersweet. Item 5D, retirees.
So we're going to be recognizing our retirees from the district this evening, and the first person being recognized is actually Gail Schmader, whose services we will greatly miss as our volunteer coordinator. So ask Principal Shedd to come up to speak.
So one of the things I was actually thinking about at graduation and thinking about doing a presentation for Gail is the number of students, as I was reading the descriptions of the students who are receiving citizenship awards at graduation, how many of them I said during the course of the presentation, "And this student was involved in the mentoring program at Pond Cove or the middle school." Because the mentoring program has just been wonderful in developing, nurturing that sense of caring and community, which I think is what Gail is really all about and has stood for many years at the Cape Elizabeth schools. It really is quite amazing. It makes sort of the high school for a good part of the day a kind of a revolving door because kids are coming and going to the other two schools, which is just a great, great feature of what's able to go on because we have a closed campus. I mean, we have a small campus, and we have a volunteer coordinator who has just poured her heart and soul into making that mentoring program a real highlight and a success. Gail has mentioned the number of thousands of hours of volunteer service this year alone, and then you multiply that by however many years Gail has been here, which is 26? 26. That is absolutely incredible, and I'll make my concluding comment about that sort of mathematically, but I also want to mention the volunteers, of whom Bill is sort of the preeminent example in the high school, but there have been others, and there are many more I know in Pond Cove in the middle school. And what sort of stands out to me is when I have occasion to look in PowerSchool and try to find a phone number or an address of a parent or a student for whatever reason, and it's amazing because one of the boxes that it gets checked is volunteer awareness training completed. And I have to say, it seems like when I look at those boxes and I'm looking at parents and I happen to notice, it's got to be well over 3/4 of the parents in Cape Elizabeth who have experienced training. And all of that training has been, I believe, delivered in person by Gail, which is absolutely phenomenal. So the last piece, sort of specific, I will mention is I think there are kids who volunteer with all kinds of and meet all kinds of needs. There are parents who meet all kinds of needs because of the sort of networking and connecting and matchmaking that Gail does so well. But I think a particular sort of area of impact and great passion is for the mentoring that happens with students with special needs in particular, as opposed to working just in an assigned classroom, which is wonderful. But it is, and that's really what Gail was just talking about in terms of some of those descriptions of feedback from the students and that sort of thing, because that connection is just absolutely priceless for those kids as they come up through the system. So I will say that Gail is, from the moment I first met her, it was very obvious that she was a woman of incredible energy and a woman of incredible organizational skills that I can't even imagine. And every now and then, like once a year, Gail would come to me and there'd been some new change to the volunteer coordination or training process, and she would run through this checklist. And I would just say, Gail, just tell me what to do. Just tell me what to do. And I just completely trust you. And the last concept I want to mention is from my Econ 101 class in college, and that is the concept of the multiplier effect. Sort of economically, the concept that each dollar that is circulated in the economy goes to another household and another household and another household, and there's this multiplier effect of putting money into the economy or income into the economy and that sort of thing. And with that sort of multiplier effect in mind, I just wanted to say thank you to Gail on behalf of all the students and staff whose lives you have touched, because you are the great Cape Elizabeth School System multiplier. So thank you so much for everything you've done, Gail.
So Gail, thank you so very much for all of your years of dedication and service. As a small token of gratitude,
we have this great privilege. As I said, I've had a grand time.
It's been our pleasure.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, Kelly said, "Can I have my office?"
Excellent. Our next retiree,
yes, is Belinda Snell, high school guidance counselor, and Principal Shedd is coming back to the podium.
So Belinda had some other family commitments that she needed to do, and also, quite honestly, she's sort of a private person. She doesn't necessarily enjoy the fanfare, although she's accepted some of it. She was gracious enough the other day when we did our senior farewell assembly to be willing to come to that assembly and be honored. And she actually received a standing ovation by the students for all the work that she's done on behalf of the seniors. And Belinda is just finishing up her 27th year at Cape Elizabeth High School. All of those years are in the role of a guidance counselor, although she also has been a teacher in the past. And she is an endlessly creative problem solver who just really works and advocates for her students. If you've had the opportunity to have your students be advised by Belinda, you know a few things. One is she really knows what she's doing based on years of experience. Two, she will give parents and students really candid, straight feedback, but always coming from the right place of concern for the student. And she always puts the student at the center of everything that she does. I remember, and both of my sons happen to have had Belinda as a guidance counselor, and I know the candid advice that she gave my older son, and she said, you're going to take this class, which was a class he didn't really want to take. And he took her advice, and it was absolutely the right advice to take. And that's really who Belinda is, but she also wins the hearts and minds of those people who work with her for any amount of time. They begin to realize where she's coming from. It was actually her idea several years ago to restructure the guidance office so that instead of having three counselors, all of whom split the entire student body by three, so that every guidance counselor dealt with some ninth graders, some 10th graders, some 11th graders, and 12th graders. It was her idea to restructure that so that there would be two dedicated counselors to work on essentially everything but college on behalf of students, and then one who would specialize in college. And that change can be misperceived as trying to put students going to college on a pedestal, but really the intent was, and the practice was, exactly the opposite, which was to make sure that there was enough guidance attention that was being given to students in the ninth grade and 10th grade, because when all of the counselors were involved in representing some portion of the senior class, particularly with the early decision onslaught that all high schools have been sort of trying to grapple with, it really took away from the ability of the counselors to meet the needs of the ninth and 10th graders whose needs were great. Yes, she is incredibly knowledgeable about what she does, not just with college, but with the other parts of her counseling role as well, which actually she was a generalist counselor for 90% of her time at Cape Elizabeth. And I'm not sure what else I can say about her, except we're losing somebody who's been a real part of creating a culture at the high school of high expectations and rigor and caring at the same time. And so I am very much appreciative of the work that she's done and the leadership that she's provided. So thank you.
Well, Jeff, don't go anywhere. In her absence, we are hoping that you can relay all appreciation to Belinda for all of her years of service.
I will absolutely get that to her.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Could I add a short story about Belinda, please?
Sure, we would love that.
My son was assigned or got the gift of Belinda when he became a freshman. And I can honestly say that there's a variety of people that have influenced my son's 4 years in high school, but Belinda was one of the major influences on his career. He wanted to go into science, he wanted to learn math, but he did not have the accelerated courses in middle school, and she figured out ways all the way through high school for him to take extra math courses, take him to different places. He ended up graduating, doing very well, ended up graduating, taking AP Calculus. He's now a chemistry major in college. And I can honestly say that Belinda Snell not only helped him pick his college, and it turned out to be one of the best picks I've ever seen, she also gave him great guidance in terms of courses to take, helped his passion to learn science and math outside the box. She was also a great human being and of great influence to my son's social, emotional development. She was a tremendous champion for him and for all kids. I say this as an example, only as an example, not because she did any great favors for my son, she did, but she did for every kid. And she is a tremendous person, very loyal, very dogged, very knowledgeable, and cares about kids more than anything. And I honestly can say my son would not have had the high school experience he did without her. And I personally want to thank her.
Thank you, David. That was very nice. Next up, I believe we have Mike.
Principal Tracy, to recognize retiree Jamie Michaud.
Okay, thank you. Jamie Michaud, it is my pleasure and honor to come up and speak on behalf of Jamie Michaud in her retirement. She's had a very long and successful career, and I feel a little bit badly. I've only known Jamie for just under 2 years, and I'll do my best to do justice, but her colleagues have already spoken so eloquently and captured the essence of Jamie Michaud, but I will do my best to just say some words that I hope to come close to what her colleagues have already said to honor and celebrate Jamie's career. As far as the work that she's done with students in terms of the writing process and a continual focus on getting students to think, read, write. If you're in Jamie's classes, you are just immersed in rich text and exploration of the writing process, and that's been a real gift to the students at the middle school. There's their study of history, and she just makes history come alive, and she absolutely loves everything that she shares with students that they read and that they write about. And you can't think of literature and Jamie, and of course not think of To Kill a Mockingbird. It's a book that has said she's read more than 20 times, and I think she reads maybe more often than that because she just loves that book and really exudes a love of literature, but especially you can't look at a version of To Kill a Mockingbird and not think of Jamie. She is not only an educator, but also a woman of just immense class and dignity and professionalism, and it's just my pleasure to be up here in my very brief relationship with Jamie as her principal. It's been a pleasure, and I congratulate you and honor you in your retirement. Congratulations, Jamie.
Ms. Michaud, it is with the deepest pleasure that we give this token of our appreciation to all the years of service, to the amazing work that you've done for the students in our district.
Thank you.
I know you will be missed.
Thank you.
You're
Thank
welcome.
You all.
Thank you. Jamie, I'd be amiss if I didn't point out that you are an eighth grade teacher,
yes.
Which is just thank you from having, you've had two of my children and the spring of eighth grade, I know, is an exceptional time of year, and you
She's still smiling.
Thank you very much
Thank
for
you
all
so
your work.
Much.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank
you.
Perfect. Next. And then next up, we have Kelly Hassan, as we have two retirees from the Pond Cove.
With recognition of retiree Karen Abbott.
So I'm not quite sure where to begin with Karen. Karen actually chose teaching as her second career, and we really were blessed that she found her true life's calling, teaching first grade. Mm-hmm. And when I first met her, I was one of her first grade colleagues, and I actually thought she drank coffee that was somehow stimulated with steroids in it, because she was just a whirling dervish with one idea after another about new teaching strategies, new children's books, new professional books, and she will kill me for this, but she's very speedy. About a month ago, somebody came into my office first thing in the morning before school started and said, "We think Karen broke her foot." And I thought, oh no, she was climbing up on something again. I've told her not to do that. And I said, oh my gosh, what was she standing on? And they said, she fell off her shoe. And so consequently, Karen has been riding around the school on one of those orthopedic scooters, so she goes even faster than normal. So every now and then you'll see something fly by, and something, and I'll have to, every now and then I say, Mrs. Abbott, we have a speed limit here at Pond Cove. So, sorry, I had to just tell that. One thing with Karen, she discovered another true passion of hers was technology as a tool for learning, and she really taught us so much. And her technology expertise actually garnered her the Maine's Technology Teacher of the Year in 2010. So she has just been an extraordinary advocate and resource for us at school, and has brought so much technology to Pond Cove as a result. Karen, you've brought so much to Pond Cove, and I feel so fortunate to have been one of your first grade colleagues, and also to have been one of the first what we call looping teachers. Karen and I looped from first to second grade together, and the fun, the learning, the stories I won't get into right now, we are going to miss you so, so much. But you have lakes to kayak, you have trails at Sugarloaf, and you also have a brand new house to make memories in your retirement. So we just thank you for all that you've given to Pond Cove, and are so, so grateful that you landed at Pond Cove, where your true life's work really was. So thank you so much. And I'm going to stop there because I need to. So thank you, Karen, for just everything.
As well as really deeply cares about the social and emotional well-being of our children. And I know this because when I went to pick up my daughter Amelia from her last day of first grade, she came running into my arms and she smelled fabulous. And I said, where did you get that smell? And behind her came you, and you told me that she had spent the entire day in your arms.
Oh, gosh.
And I just will always remember. So thank you for all the children that you have.
Could I add something for Karen as well? You always remember the last teachers that your child may have. You also remember the first. And Karen was the first teacher for my son, Zachary. And I happened to mention to him, I haven't seen this agenda that she was going to be up, and he wanted me to thank you, and all the Hillmans thank you for a wonderful introduction to education that you gave our son. We will never forget it.
Thank you, Karen.
Karen, your love of children has shined through every single day. So, David, thank you for those comments.
And Principal Austin, stayed at the podium to recognize retiree Tracy Greenwood.
So, Tracy, I happen to know before she became our EdTech extraordinaire in our media center. I actually had Tracy's youngest daughter, Alice, in my first grade classroom. I was 12 at the time. She is now married and has her own child. And so it was just, and Tracy was an amazing volunteer. And so we were just delighted when she started working for us in the media center. To put Tracy's gifts and her brilliance and just her go-to spirit into words, I don't think there's a word invented. I really don't. And this is hard to call. She may be the most dependable person in Pond Cove, and that's saying a lot. That's of no offense to anyone in Pond Cove, but she has got to be, I think, the most dependable person in Pond Cove. And something that always comes to mind is back when we were using VCRs, and inevitably something would go wrong. My students would always say, go find Mrs. Greenwood. And she just could fix anything. But she just, she was amazing with her love of children, her love of books, her recommendations of books. And that was both for children and for adults. Passionate reader, she would go to Westport, Mass, where her family is every summer, and tell us stories about that. And it's just been, Tracy, it's just been a pure joy having you. And this is, how long have we been together? It's been a long time. No, it's been, so I just really, really congratulate you on, and thank you so much, and I'm so happy that you're going to get to spend time with your husband, your children, your grandchildren, my former first grader, but congratulations, and thank you so, so much for all you've done. We are not quite sure how we're going to replace you, but so thank you, Tracy, for everything.
We've made a donation to the Wayside Food Program. Thank you for your years of service. Welcome.
So this is intermission.
This is intermission.
The board takes a little break to spend some time with our retirees, and so we will be moving off air temporarily for a little intermission, and we'll regroup.
We'll regroup in a minute. Thank you. Thank you. So back to our regularly scheduled program. We have item 5E, Administrators' Strategic Plan Updates, Indicators of Success. We have a volunteer. Do we have a tribute?
Okay, hello.
Thank you.
So I was just going to report out, I think, more on what's on the horizon for next year and what we're looking forward to. Working with Ruth Allen and looking, we're in the process of receiving proposals for summer work. And as we prepare for next year, the middle school is really gearing up for preparing to do some standards-based grading and reporting, as I've talked to you about. And I think the proposals that are coming in and that we'll be reviewing are some really great work that's very aligned to the standards-based grading and proficiency-based grading. A lot of the unit of study work and the understanding by design structure for the units. So there's some really thoughtful proposals that are coming forward that, as I said, we'll take a look at and review. But I'm very excited about the kind of work that it's preparing the middle school teachers to dive into next year. So I'm hearing a lot more dialogue and teachers thinking aloud about, okay, so this is what it could look like, and this is the work we're going to do. And probably most importantly, they're talking about doing it collaboratively and hearing a lot of great teamwork and seeing a lot of examples of teachers getting together and rolling up their sleeves and talking about whether it's standards alignment, development of common assessments, setting clear targets, setting benchmarks, looking at tracking systems, how do you set up standards-based grade books, and all of that are all signs of what's to come. And so I think there are a lot of foundational pieces that we continue to build. And while sometimes foundational work isn't glamorous and all that, it has to be in place for us to be successful next year. So I'm here just to report out that there's a lot of great structural foundational work that's sort of happening in the background as we look forward to beginning some piloting work of what that proficiency-based, standards-based reporting is going to look like. Two other areas we're really looking to continue to refine our enrichment block that was built into our master schedule for our first year. And what we've learned from that and the ways we're hoping to really hone in and refine on how we can use that time. It has a lot of potential for us to not only provide extension and enrichment, but to provide targeted support and intervention work for some of our students. So we had a great start. Having it in our master schedule is important, and I think we can build from year one and really do some great work with that time that we've maintained in our master schedule for next year. And we'll be gearing up and continuing our second round of the Stand Up, Speak Up training that Steve Wessler helped us to put together, and we've had several students already go through round one, and we'll be ready to pick up and keep training our next group and so on and so on and so on. So we're doing a lot of that work. It's going to keep going, and there'll be some great work going on this summer, so I'm happy to share out about that. So.
Are there any questions for Principal Tracy?
Mike, when do you anticipate the start of standards-based reporting and the change from your traditional report card? Is sixth already there? Are you aiming at seventh next year? Can you remind us what that timeline of implementation is?
Sure. And by sixth, did you mean grade?
Grade
level? We're not at a place where I can say a whole grade level or school-wide or will be reporting out and ready to do that. It's really going to depend on all of the foundational pieces and how far along we are. So a lot of the language and a lot of the processes that you'll be seeing will really be pilot format. I have particular teams at particular grade levels who are wrestling with what does this mean, how are we going to collect information in a proficiency-based way and report it out. So I have teams who are proposing, we'd like to try this next year, we'd like to pilot it, do some study group work, and then report out to our staff about helping them along.
It's almost more cross grade level by content versus grade level?
More so, yes. I think
so you see the whole middle school at some point in a year or two
being ready to
That's my hope and intention, but we won't be there next year, but we will have some very effective piloting work that we'll learn a lot from and be able to teach each other and develop expertise. So, you're welcome.
Are there other questions for Principal Tracy? Yes?
That was, one of my questions was, the state gives us things to do, and then the state takes away things that we have, that we thought we had to do. So how are the teachers doing on believing that this is really going to happen? Like, how's the, you know, how do teachers feel about it, and how are they doing knowing that they have to do this work?
Right.
Have they bought that it is definitely going to happen? And
right. What I think's meaningful here is they don't see it as an add-on or something that's a have-to. They're really recognizing the aspects of standards-based grading and instruction and proficiency-based work. They're seeing the value to the quality of teaching and learning. And so it's really kind of driven, ground-up, grassroots there. They recognize that it is best practice and it's important work, so they seem very excited and inspired by it. So it's not something they're gripping on and saying, oh, let's wait this out and this is going to go away. They're really having very meaningful, thoughtful, collaborative work sessions about, we know this is where we need to go, and it doesn't matter if someone's saying we have to or not. People are really talking about, we know this is good for kids and it's good for teaching and learning. So.
Thank you, and thank you. Please tell them that I understand that it's new work and it's hard work, and I appreciate their delving into it.
That's great. I will pass that along. Thank you.
I did have just one quick procedural question.
Sure.
Around the master schedule. Is that published yet?
It is.
It
yes.
is published yet.
Yes.
And has there been a lot of differences in this year's master schedule from last year's master schedule?
It's not. On the whole, it's very similar. The overall template looks very similar. We just have a couple of sub adjustments that were made to it, but on the whole, we looked at it with our scheduling committee, did finish their work. We shared it with the result with the scheduling committee, team leaders at the beginning of the week, shared it out with staff earlier in the day today, and it was published to the community this afternoon. So it's a good model. It's a great use of time. There's a lot of equitable use of the available time that we have. Of course, we'd always love more and more and more, and I'm sure we'd fill it to the fullest extent, but it really accomplishes a lot of the priorities we went into it wanting to accomplish. So we maintained a lot of great parts that we were able to build last year, and we added a few different small twists to it this year, but it looks good.
Hard work.
Yeah.
Any other questions, Principal Tracy?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great, thank you.
Principal Hassan.
I know this will disappoint you, but I have this persistent cough, so I'm going to be more brief than I usually am. So I just wanted to, going on the heels of Mike, my updates are more about moving forward as it's June, so what next year is going to look like. It was mentioned about Miki when she was giving her presentation. In fact, I told her, I said, if you want to stay, I'm actually going to mention you again. So technology integrator and teacher Tom Chaltre is creating what he's calling the Creation Station, and it's going to be very similar to a makerspace. And so he asked Miki and her friend Amy Rasko if they would paint, and they're not quite done yet, but when they are, I'll take a photo and feature it in the newsletter outside. And what he's planning to do, and he's actually able to do it with current resources that we have at the moment. His plan is to redesign what is inside. So picture the computer lab has desktop computers right now, and those desktop computers are still going to be, they'll go around the perimeter, tables will be in the middle, and that will allow for more innovative work being done in the middle using, he's got a plan starting like with Legos, moving to robotics, doing, and you know, obviously using iPads, because there's really not a lot of space to use iPads in there. And even though he does a lot of push-in with integrating with teachers in the classrooms, he really wants to make that place more than just a computer lab. So it's pretty exciting. So that's one piece I wanted to share with you. So I told Miki she could watch it on TV if she wanted, but if she wanted to stay. So Miki, if you want to go home, you can now. Okay. Okay. So you've been a trooper, but really we're so fortunate. And I would say just the art the children are doing around the school now, it's almost as if the 250 projects have really inspired children and even teachers to say, can you do this? We've got musical notes now being painted outside of the music room. We've got a giraffe being painted outside, you know, that's coming out of the art room. So it's the children are taking ownership, which is, you know, it's better than, you know, hiring someone to, it's really exciting. So if you haven't been by Pond Cove lately, drop by and see. It's really like a museum. And we're telling the children that too, you know, that tide pool, you know, be careful, it's like a museum. And they're being really respectful of each other's art, so it's really exciting. Bree Gallagher, excuse me, recently sent out a survey to parents that was more specific to Pond Cove, because we know the survey that was sent out, the parent satisfaction and engagement survey that was sent out, does include something about guidance, but because guidance is so different in each of the schools, she's more, we don't even really call her guidance officer, you know, we say she's our school counselor. So she sent out something specific so she could get feedback that would help inform what do parents, you know, value that she does, what do they want, you know, is there something they would like to see her do more of, what experiences have they had that, and how's that gone? So that's an update. excuse me. And this summer, we've been comparing, this summer, not yet, we've been comparing and contrasting measuring pre and post assessments, and that has helped inform work with Ruth Ellen on our Open Door Studios again. And so that will be happening again this summer, so we've been sending out invitations to that and informing parents about that. So we'll have more information to share with that, but using a variety of assessments and looking at cross-curricular. So that is coming up this summer. And we're getting different proposals for summer professional development and cross-curricular, culture, everything. And I won't get into right now because I know it's on the agenda later, but we're restructuring how we do team leaders. And Meredith can tell you a bit more about that. But one thing I did want to share with you is this book. And Meredith, I brought the book. Remember I met with Meredith the other day and I said, this is a great book and we're going to use it this summer with how we're restructuring team leaders. And I could not remember the title. I didn't have it. And I said, you know, I know you've read it. You must have read it. It's fairly new. It has the word happiness in it. And she's going, Kelly, there's a lot of books that have the word happiness in it. And so I said, you know, anyway, it's called, and you may have heard of it, it's called The End of the Rainbow. And the subtitle is How Educating for Happiness, and in parentheses, Not Money, Would Transform Our Schools, and it's by Susan Engel. And I'm just going to just give you a snippet of just a very brief summary. Not the whole page. Then I'm done. and it says, the end of the rainbow asks, what would happen if we changed the implicit goal of education and, thank you, Kate. If I could see to find my glasses, I would have known that. The end of the rainbow asks, what would happen if we changed the implicit goal of education and imagine how different things would be if we made happiness rather than money the graduation prize. Drawing on psychology, education theory, and a broad range of classroom experiences across the country, Susan Engel offers a fascinating alternative view of what education might become, teaching children to read books for pleasure and self-expansion and encouraging collaboration. All of these new skills, she argues, would not only cultivate future success in the world of work, but also would make society as a whole a better, happier place. And we thought that that would really be a wonderful jumping off place this summer for working on school culture. And if this is a fairly new book, but she has been featured in the New York Times. There's a small piece that she did recently in the New York Times, and that's what brought my attention to this book. And so we think this, so I just ordered, Meredith got the PO. I've just ordered a bunch of them for our team leaders to read this summer. So together, so we'll have a book group this summer, but I just wanted to share that part with you. And I don't think I can talk anymore, but are there any questions?
A month or two ago, you talked to us about the action plan about math instruction and the monitor status, and now I don't know what's going to happen with all the changes in testing that's coming our way, but can you tell us any specifics this summer about math that's on your mind?
What we've done is a survey. Ruth Ellen put together a survey about math, and all the teachers filled it out, and each team has been meeting. There's one more team that still needs to meet, and so we'll have an update about what they've decided. It's looking at this point, we are going to do professional development this summer. Everyday Math is offered it for free. But I think an important piece that we've really made clear to teachers is we're not teaching a program, we're teaching the standards, and the program is a resource, any program. But we also don't want to just be program specific, we want to bring in other resources too and talk to, obviously, other schools, other practitioners, but bring in, look for what some robust professional development around the standards really can bring for us. And we also have ordered, I did not bring those, and Meredith, I can't think of a word to remember from one of them. I think it has the word math in it. But we've got a couple of really good math professional development books that are guiding us with the standards, Common Core, that the teachers have reviewed and really like. So that's going to help. So it won't be just about, going by a manual. It will be really in differentiation and how, which things can go, which things we need to enhance and get more, and do more cross-grade level, do more cross-grade level discussions, which we try. It's the schedule that throws us off, but we just have to make a commitment to it. And also, this summer we're going to be developing a lot of pre-assessments that are not program specific, so they are going to be standard specific, so that we can go in and know, Barbara, Kate, and Joe, they know these geometry concepts very well. There's no need for them, and Meredith, okay, so you're all in different classes, so maybe it makes sense for during the part, either all or part of a unit that another teacher might be, you might go into another classroom, and in turn, Susanna, David, and John might need some extra help, but they're all in different classes, so they may go into another class. So it's really teaching smart, and it's really being more flexible with that, so that we
more can, performance grouping and really
absolutely yeah.
So really a way to sort of hit the tier two piece of RTI, which
absolutely
has been a gap, mm-hmm. I think, and this is really.
Yeah.
Third year sort of in development, so there's right. Good progress towards that work.
Great, thank you.
Yeah. No. I'm glad you asked the question. That was something that we've been having a lot of discussion about lately. So any other questions? Any artists you want to come over and paint? Thank you.
I have a question. I didn't know, have we gotten a plan? Will you help me remember? Because we'll have one more meeting in public. We won't have another meeting in public about the professional development days and what it'll be planned for next year. Because I know.
Oh, right.
I don't think we meet in public again. And
right.
We've been talking about it, but we don't.
What we will do, we will, we're still working on that, quite honestly, and we talked about, okay, we need to, I actually said, okay, I need to go to June 9th school meeting with this plan, okay, with what we're doing. And we've gone back and forth. We didn't want to do a premature thing, so we'll post it, and we'll definitely post it and include it in newsletters, but post it for the summer, so you know, because it's kind of going back and forth, and you know, we've kind of gone back and forth, and also people are coming up with different resources they want to use and saying, oh, we want to use, you know, this. One thing I know for sure, the first thing that we want, the first half day that we have, we want to really devote to culture, you know, so that we can really, you know, develop a really strong foundation for making sure that we have a strong culture for staff, culture for students, so we know that that is going to be our first one. And math probably will be the second one. You know, that's so far what we've done. We want to give equitable time to each, but we also want to be smart about, we need to devote so much time to this as we do to something else. So, but thank you for asking that question, because it was in the plan for me to have that, and people kept going back and forth, and I said, okay, I'm not going to give them a fake plan, okay, so, but we'll post it, and you should know it. We have to make the plan by before the end of the school year.
Thank you, because I think it's important for, it was such a public.
Right,
and
absolutely.
That the public deserves the right to know what they're, we've got planned. And that, thank you.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Others?
Any other questions for Principal Hassan? Thank you so much. Exciting stuff happening. Ruth Ellen Vaughn.
And to building on what Kelly has said, looking forward, we're looking at a number of professional development opportunities for teachers and staff throughout the summer. We have local, regional, and national conferences that are being offered to teachers. Math, student engagement, differentiation, technology, writing, classroom culture, and then a few that are kind of in various specialty areas, but those are the broad pieces that we're looking at across the time. Right now for summer work, there are currently 53 proposals from teachers for the three buildings that the principals and I will be reviewing over the next week or so for summer work. And a number of those proposals are put together by groups of teachers. So we have a number of people who've stepped up and said, yes, this is what I want to work on this summer, and here's how it aligns, and here's what we propose. And we'll be reviewing those and see how far the budget goes and what our latitude is for that. We're continuing to work on the technology skills checklist. Our science alignment is underway, and math and science work will be priorities this summer. The math, as Kelly mentioned, at Pond Cove, the focus is going to be working on those pre- and post-assessments that are specifically standards-based as opposed to being a Unit 4 test in. It's so that it really doesn't matter what teachers are using. Middle school is looking at similar type of alignments with their math programs. Both schools are looking at what type of supplementary materials we want to bring in, what type of parallel series we might want to investigate to see if there are some pieces that better suit our needs than what we've been using currently. It doesn't mean that we are dropping anything across the board, but we want to make sure that any decisions that we make do make sense and that they are giving us the latitude to meet student needs where we need to. Piloting of our evaluation plan will be occurring, hopefully next fall. It will be occurring. We are still in the process of putting the rest of that draft together, and we'll be meeting tomorrow afternoon to get those final pieces in. Our first full year of STAR data has been completed at Pond Cove. I don't have as much data for the middle school, but we have now a good foundation for our benchmarks for students moving forward. As Kelly mentioned, we are looking at that for our summer work. We're also using that as our baselines in comparison with NWEA, the STAR data, and now whatever it is we have for state assessments. We'll see where that ends up moving forward, but at least it's given us another data point that is Common Core aligned, that gives us the opportunity to really be looking at what our students know and are able to do. And teachers are starting to get a better handle of how that can be used now to inform their instruction. And some of the summer work will be looking at that data as we move forward. Summer school enrollments currently are fairly light. We had a really good response last summer, and I thought, oh boy, we'll expand. Right now, my numbers aren't looking like we're having a large expansion. I am in the process of trying to get my final enrollments together and to see where my staffing is going to be. That program may actually be somewhat compacted this year, but we'll see who we have and how we can best meet the needs of the students that have signed up. So, any questions?
With the summer program, have you already contacted the students that have been identified that would benefit? And those, you know, assuming you have, and then thereafter, how and when do you open up to others who have not?
We have contacted first tier, we've contacted second tier, at some levels we've contacted third tier, and I had also opened up back in March when we first sent out the initial, keep in mind the date, if families already knew that they wanted their students considered, let us know, and I've kept an interested families list, and they're on the list as well. So I don't know how many more tiers of interest I have left,
yeah.
But I'm willing to beat the bushes. But at this point, I understand that family schedules for the summer are very packed, and sometimes it's tough to make a four-week commitment. I understand that. So. We'll see where we can go. I'm excited with what we have planned, and we'll see where that is.
Any other questions?
Just a quick one, and maybe, I don't know if this is for you or Meredith, but is the, you mentioned having the pilot ready to go next year for teacher eval. Did that include the principal eval, the administrative eval plan too?
Our teacher draft is a little more solid than our principal draft, but they will both be drafted and both be piloted as we're looking at right now.
We received yesterday the survey from the state. Originally it was going to be you have to turn in your plan, and then it was, well, maybe we'll give you a list of questions, and now it's a survey of a few
where are
questions,
you?
Yeah.
Sort of
47
where
questions.
You are, but the information in the survey, which we've been unable to really get many answers up until we received the survey information today, but the information that we have in the survey is that sort of you need to be ready to go by September 30th, and they want sort of confirmation from us that we'll be ready to go by September 30th, and we feel very confident that we will be.
Will we have a chance to learn more about what all this looks like? This has to be board approved at some point, I'm sure.
At some point.
Yeah.
Your draft doesn't necessarily have to be approved because
right.
it's not
right.
even being approved by the state
right.
anymore.
Right.
But we expect that the steering committee, who will sort of take over the monitoring of the pilot under the law, will be then making any revisions and then bringing an ultimate draft word to the board sometime next spring.
Thanks. So you went with Kim Marshall for teachers. What did you go with principals?
Was the there? Discussion with the committee has been continuing with the Kim Marshall.
With Kim Marshall's
rubrics for principals as well.
Thank you.
Any others? Are there any other questions from the panel?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Shedd.
So just some quick updates in the area of sort of school culture, I guess, three things, and sort of student engagement, social emotional engagement in particular, is we did do a beginning of a second round of the Wessler training by teachers. They sort of collaborated together as a team so that they could make sure they had a second experience of sharing that training before the end of the school year. That was just a couple weeks ago. We're in the process of evaluating our advisory program and deciding how we want to tweak it, make any alterations to it. We surveyed all the students to see what their reactions were to the advisory program, and I'm getting together with a group of grade level coordinators about that early next week. We got a grant from the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation to support the opening of what, tentatively at least, we're calling a Freshman Achievement Foundations cohort, to sort of work in an interdisciplinary way with kids to sort of help them through the transition. Kids particularly who have been identified to us as from middle school staff as kids who might need some additional support, and looking at skills to be successful in high school and skills to help them get to know themselves better. And I do anticipate that one of the pieces of that program will be sort of community outreach and finding places where they can feel really successful out in the community as well. There's a lot of details that we still have to work out about that, and I'd be glad to share as we develop some work. One of the areas of summer professional development that a group of folks will be spending is giving greater clarity to that program. So, and again, on the theme of interdisciplinary sort of connections and work, I am personally excited that we ran a master's schedule this year. For the last bunch of years, we have had common planning time for each of our core academic departments. But this year we decided to run a master schedule that worked and didn't create more problems than it solved. That actually allows for common planning time for English, history, and foreign language. We'll all have a common planning period. So it provides some exciting opportunities, I think, in terms of finding interdisciplinary possibilities, connections, developing common vocabulary among teachers that they use with kids. And math and science will also have a common planning plan as well. And for the first time, the health and physical education teachers and the arts teachers will also have common planning times as well. So I think there's some real opportunities. Our first draft was sort of a first floor common planning time as well, which would have incorporated all the health PE and arts folks and technology folks, and unfortunately that was the one that kind of broke the camel's back in terms of creating conflict. So we had to back off of that, so we were able at least to develop a common planning time departmentally for those areas. And the last part I think I will report is we did last week notify all current sophomore and junior students of a pilot program that we're starting that we're calling student-driven learning, which is essentially allowing students an opportunity to propose particular independent study projects that would take them out in the community, exploring an area of passion and those sorts of things. Our anticipation is that the person who was hired to be the extended learning opportunity coordinator would be sort of instrumental in making that work, giving definition to that, and meeting with groups of students who are selected to participate in this program as sort of a cohort on a very, very regular, quite frequent basis. So we're looking at this as a pilot to see what we do and borrowing ideas from other schools. And we are beginning to get applications in from students on a fairly quick turnaround time. But we're excited about it certainly has created a lot of discussion, I think, in the school. So I'll be fascinated to see what comes forward. I was talking with Nate Carpenter, the assistant principal, who got an email from a student who happens to be a PAS student, and he, I think that his proposal, if Nate is predicting correctly, is going to be about creating and building his own 3D printer, which would be really, really kind of cool. Kind of cool.
So cool.
So thank you to the board for supporting that position, which I think is really instrumental in allowing us to explore that traditional area of independent study and pushing it into some non-traditional areas. I think that's a great opportunity for our kids. So
that's
thank you
exciting.
Very
thank
much
you.
For that.
Okay. Are there any questions for Mr. Sharp?
No. I would just add that it was great to be back at a Cape Elizabeth High School graduation after 16 years, and it's just as fabulous as I remember it leaving. The setting, the tone, it was just terrific. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, I just want to know what your secret is, because I know you were out all night on Sunday night with Project Graduation, and yet you look so awake right now.
I was thinking you must not have gone.
Lots of practice. How was project graduation?
It was wonderful. It really was. I will say the class of 2015, in so many ways, we're blessed to have lots of wonderful kids. So, but there were some particular touches that this class added that were really kind of really neat. And project graduation was very nice. We went to Port City Music Hall. And there were some wonderful DJs that the kids really enjoyed. And they were dancing all night. And the fascinating thing was, there was no grinding at all. There is a cultural change in place, for which I have zero responsibility, but I am more than delighted to watch them.
Just dance.
Just having just a lot of fun. So that was really cool. And then we went to, it's a place called The Works, which is in Somersworth, New Hampshire. It's a quite large facility that has actually some elements of indoor water park. It has a couple of pools, but it's much more than just an indoor water park. It had a gymnasium that had big, huge inflatable things that the project graduation committee had rented, just tons of food, racquetball courts, volleyball courts, and the kids just had a great time. And the really cool thing about project graduation is watching the different groups of kids in the way that by the end of senior year they're crossing their friendship groups and seeing who's playing in the volleyball court and how just friendly and warm and welcoming it was. It was really, really neat experience.
Well, thanks, because I learned more from you now than I did.
Since you asked me about project graduation, I will say that the credit for project graduation goes to some really hard-working parents every single year who just work their tails off to raise a lot of money and to really put together a great program for kids to keep them safe.
You did a great job. Thanks for that. Okay, moving right along. Item 5F, the National Center for School Leadership annual survey results. And the survey says...
We're still on page one.
But that's okay. It's lots of pages of names.
Yeah.
Let's hope.
And it's only 9:05, and I'm still young. Yeah.
Up as well.
I think I might.
There's Luke.
Lots of food.
So, while we're waiting for this to load, this is the second year that we conducted the student and parent engagement surveys, and the staff survey, climate and culture survey, is in process. We expect it to be completed by the end of school. But we're going to report tonight on the student and parent results, maybe.
Try this one more time.
So this survey was conducted back in... Oh. And now I have no screen, so that'll make it interesting.
I might have to leave that button, seriously. Declan and I were
okay, so Kelly warned me that she may have played the button.
Button over there.
But that's okay. We're going to try again and see if we can get this. Yeah, I need to be able to see myself. There we go. Okay, here we go. We'll go back. So the survey was conducted, again, to sort of help us continue our work around identifying progress that we're making towards our mission and vision and to make sure that we're collecting stakeholder input on some of the work that we're doing. The survey was done this year in January, mid to late January, because we were also doing the NEAS survey at the high school during our fall window, so we held off and conducted the survey during the winter window. And we got the results on March 27th, and so those results were reviewed by leadership in April and May. Some guidelines around how the scores were interpreted, and over at my seat are about 700 pages worth of data that comes out of this survey, and that doesn't include the comments, which are another 100 or so pages of information. So there's a lot to digest, so we're really only hitting the high points. And I'm hitting sort of district-level high points, and then building administrators are working in their buildings and with their faculty and through their own analysis to look at what some of the specific pieces are for them. So strengths are, you know, if you had more than a 75% favorable rating, they're considered real strengths. And this survey comes from the National Center for School Leadership. And so it's a national survey that includes hundreds of thousands of students and parents and faculty members. So it's a well-vetted survey. If our results are at least 10% above the national average, it's considered a very positive strength. And they consider opportunities, places where we have a 20% or more unfavorable rating from our constituents, things you want to work on. And if we're 10% or more below the national average, better shine a spotlight on that and figure out what exactly is going on. The Student Engagement and Satisfaction Survey, which I'll speak to first, looks at the items listed up there: school climate, relationships, voice choice, feedback, goal setting, student engagement, and flexible teaching styles. Again, things that very much resonate with our mission and vision and values, which is part of the reason we chose this survey initially. And so some significant strengths that we saw relative to the national averages: 86% of our kids say they're satisfied with the overall quality of their school. 83% say they're treated fairly by adults at school. 62% say teachers provide me with specific input on how I'm performing in school. 59% say teachers listen and respond when I have something to say. 76%, sorry about that. And 60% say my teachers readily listen to and accept student ideas and suggestions about classwork. Again, those are all significantly above the national averages. Some other very positive strengths: I feel safe at school, which I think is something we all value and want to hear from our kids. But again, contrasted with the national average, 90% of our kids are saying they feel safe at school. 89% say their parents are well-informed about academic progress, and that lines up pretty well with what you see on the parent survey a little bit later. 89% say they feel encouraged to do well in school. 88% say they understand the academic expectations that the school has for them. And 86% say my teachers help me with schoolwork when I need it. So again, more information that students are feeling sort of supported in the school environment. Some weaknesses. This one, maybe not one that we're terribly concerned about this year, but I know how I've performed on the most recent standardized tests.
Was this asked before or after?
Before. Before, so it would have referred to last year's, and again, if you're a high school student, you haven't tested every year, and so again, this survey was administered to students in grades 5 through 12, and may or may not be particularly informative for them. I'm provided with useful information about careers, colleges, and other opportunities. Again, we're sort of in line with the national average, but it is one of our more lower-ranked numbers, and again, when you think about this is sort of grades 5 through 12, students in middle school are likely, and as you look at the data, are reporting that a little bit less than their older peers. My school provides students with many options in terms of classes to take. 16% unfavorable. So that's a little hard to read. If you need to borrow my glasses, let me know. But so here are areas for improvement. And these are, again, the percentages that are identified here are the unfavorable percentages, so this is why they're identified as areas for improvement. Again, a number of students are saying either neutral or more positive things, but if you have more than 20% responding unfavorably, the way that this data is recommended for interpretation by the National Center for School Leadership is this is a concern, something that you should look at. David, I saw your hand.
I'm a little confused. Maybe it's just because these metrics are a little bit hard for me to grasp. I keep trying to add them to get to 100. But it's So what were the rankings? Favorable, okay, unfavorable?
So there's a five-point scale ranging from, like, highly yes, this is absolutely great, to no, this is terrible, as a one. And so favorable ratings are fours and fives, neutral ratings are threes, and unfavorable ratings are ones and twos.
So is it technically possible to have, on a particular question, you have 15% say unfavorable, but 75% say wonderful?
Yes.
So the selection of being unfavorable is 10, 15, 20% say unfavorable.
Right.
Could so, reflect that the people have tremendously diverse opinions on something.
Absolutely, but I think it's also useful to look at the national averages, which is why I've included those here. So if you look at the first bullet there, my school provides students with many options in terms of classes to take. 22% of our students said they didn't feel that that was the case, meaning they gave a one and a two. But only 15% of students nationally said that. So again, yes, there are many layers of that, but the suggestion to us is we should be taking a look at that and identifying, is this something that needs attention? And you know, you just heard Jeff report on one of the ways the high school is addressing choice for students by giving them the opportunity to propose credit earning opportunities that connect to their passions and interests. Our extended learning opportunity coordinator position is another way that we're working towards addressing that particular issue.
Okay.
One of the metrics that is incorporated in our strategic plan indicators of success is the next one. I'm very interested in my schoolwork. 22% of our students responded unfavorably to that, so meaning about one in five kids is saying, no, not really, as compared to 28% of students nationally. So they were a little above the national. The national's closer to one in three. Third bullet, my schoolwork requires me to think, and this is another one included in our indicators of success, about how various topics relate to real life situations. Again, about one in five of our students saying not so much. Next bullet, my schoolwork often consists of using hands-on examples as part of the learning process. Again, about one in four of our students, 27%, saying that isn't their experience. My teachers align their lessons to match my personal learning style. Again, 35% or a little bit more than one in three of our students don't feel that that's the case. 26% of our students say my teachers responded unfavorably to the question, my teachers seem to understand how I learn best. And 21% of our students responded unfavorably to the prompt, the teachers in my school do a good job of making the material interesting to me. So again, these are things for us to look at, explore, think about. You read them with the comments. You look at them in terms of sort of conversation and dialogue. And so that the overwhelming responses to the survey are highly favorable. But these are particular areas, many of which align with some of the things we've identified in our indicators of success as wanting to look at and make progress with. Student voice and choice, student engagement, student motivation, students finding the work that they do in school more relevant to their futures. Some concerns that we identified in going through this work, 48% of our students, so less than half, are saying bullying is not a problem at their school. So meaning 52% of students are saying that bullying is, or perceive that bullying is a problem. And that number is lower than our number last year. So 2014, 58% of our students said that bullying was a problem. Again, that's an area we're paying a lot of attention to with our work with Steve Wessler and our climate and culture work across the district, the civil rights team at the middle school. 71% of our students report that they have at least one teacher or counselor who knows them well. This is the insert there as a person. Again, that's data that's also included in our, that particular prompt is also part of one of the measures of our indicators of success. We also use our main integrated youth health survey response to that particular question. Last year, the average was 76%. This year, it's 71%.
It's within the margin of error.
It's within the margin of error, absolutely. And that's true for most of these. You'll see that on the next one as well. And 46% of our students, so again, less than half, report that schoolwork requires them to think about how topics relate to real life situations. So again, areas that, as we think about our progress moving forward and our growth as a district, things we want to continue to attend to. Can we switch gears to look at the parent engagement and satisfaction survey? So it's, again, looking at the things you see listed there, academics, communication, discipline, homework, progress monitoring, engagement, satisfaction, responsiveness, and climate and pride in schools. So our very positive strength, and again, this is where I suggested that it aligns well with what we hear from our students, but parents are regularly checking information and are very involved. 95% of them report that they attend most school events offered to parents, including parent-teacher conferences and open houses. And any of you who have tried to park anywhere near the schools on nights when those events are occurring know full well that that is a pretty representative number. My child's school is well regarded in the community. Again, 89% of our parents feel that that's the case. And a relative strength, 5% above the national average. My child's school is superior to other schools in the area. So about 2/3 of our parents, 64%, report that they find that to be true. Areas for improvement, and these were the only two areas in our parent survey that had ratings of 20% or more parents responding unfavorably. The school does a great job of challenging my child to his or her fullest potential. Again, about 1/4 of our parents feel that that's not the case. And again, that relates to our work around differentiation, our work to strengthen and develop this year, our GT piece to make sure that we're serving students who need that work, our summer school work, all of those pieces. And then the next area, and I think I refer to this later on as well, but oftentimes my child's homework assignment requires interaction with me or others in our family. Not necessarily something that every assignment is going to require, but part of sometimes what we're looking for, what I think many of us as educators look for in a homework assignment is it something the child can do on his or her own? And they have the requisite skills to be able to do this independent practice that essentially is the homework assignment.
So I'm confused. Are they saying that being able to do it independently is favorable or unfavorable?
So what this question really is trying to get at is that is there a level of interaction? Does my child interact with me around homework? Do I need to get involved here? And use that as a positive?
Okay. I guess it would also depend on the age of the student.
Again, these are 5th through 12th grade parents responding. Well, actually, parents responding are all grades. Students who responded are 5 through 12. Concerns, again, as we look at our mission, vision, and values and some of the goals that we've identified, 57% of parents report that the school does a good job of meeting the needs of all of its students. So, again, within the margin of error of last year was at 55%, but not quite 2/3 of our parents, a little more than half. 47% of our parents, and again, this is pretty consistent with the student number, report that their child's school does an excellent job dealing with student bullying. 51% of parents report that the school offers them or her opportunities to explore areas of interest outside the core content areas. Again, that's one that also aligns pretty closely with the student results. And 51% of parents report that the school does a great job of challenging my child to his or her full potential. So, in summary, our district results, and again, this is a highlight and the full 380 pages of each survey is available online as a PDF, but district results are overall really favorable and pretty consistent with the national data. You see that our students feel safe, they feel supported, they feel encouraged, which I think is what you need as a foundation in order to grow. We did hear from them, again, that they're looking for increased choice, some more relevance and personalization. Parents are active and involved and take great pride in their child's school, which I think you all can take pride in as well. And again, the pieces where we see concerns from them are around sort of increased choice and challenge. That's it in a nutshell. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Will you tell me again, tell us again about how you use this data to make changes in, how do you work, first you work with administrators, how do you break it down?
So I sent the data to administrators. They get the full results, including the comment pieces. And it's it's essentially sort of, we reported to you a little bit about the pieces that specifically tied to our indicators of success at our workshop last month. But it's using that information to share, and I'm sure any of them can speak to that, but it's sharing with their staff. Okay, what do we see? You know, sitting down and saying, what do we see as concerns here? What do we see as highlights? What themes do we notice? It's a data walk, essentially, through here's the information. What does it tell us about our work with students? Where do we see concerns? And again, each building's data is a little bit different, and the themes that they're going to glean from that are a little bit different than what we might see as the district level. But as the district level, these are pieces that sort of rise to the surface. Last year, for example, we talked about how at the middle school, there was a particular concern about choice, right? And so that was a particular theme that stood out most at the middle school as we looked at the data last year. At the high school, I think the connection to adults was a piece that was focused on, which was part of the impetus for the advisory work. So it's informing the work that we do with students moving forward and with parents. And again, I think what we see is overall, parents are generally pretty satisfied with the communication that they're getting from the district, that they have access to information, that they feel that they're informed, they know how to see how their students are doing academically, that, you know, they get newsletters and communication, and, you know, there are several of those 380 pages that talk about those kinds of pieces. But they also say, hey, I'm not so sure my child's challenged. And we're a community with very high expectations, we know that. And so the value of having the national data is that it helps us really sort of look at that through a more normative lens. As you know, aside from the, you know, people joke about the Lake Wobegon, everybody here is above average, but we do have a lot of students here who perform above average. And so our expectations as a result increase, but not every student is performing above average. And so we have to honor every child as a part of that process. So to give you the examples, I think the most concrete examples that I can give you are how the data informs some of the work that took place this year, informing the advisory system, informing the work with Steve Wessler around civil rights, informing the work that we're doing around voice and choice and the pieces Jeff described for the extended learning opportunity pieces for kids.
That's right.
Are there any more questions for Barbara and then John?
Two things I wanted to know. I went through all of this at home.
Sure.
in detail. I thought it was really interesting. I like how you sort of flipped the unfavorable. Instead of celebrating always the 80% said yes, there are 20% saying maybe not so much. And yep. Those are definitely worth looking at. I had misread, I think to David's question about what does that represent when you're showing the unfavorables, and it is a reminder that despite 80-85% approvals, there still is a handful of students who have some needs that we're looking to meet. The second observation though I met is, even though most things look pretty grand, and maybe Mike has a comment to make about this too, but and maybe it's told in the comments area, but it was noticeably stronger, robust responses elementary, high school, with a dip in the middle.
Yep.
And I wondered if it's because of some of the work that's happening right now, Michael, that's making things feel a little more not as carefully organized as maybe they've been in the past, or is it just because of the age of the kids? But both the kids and the parents had a little lower positive responses on many questions.
And if you look at the summary that the middle school provided last year, you see that that's pretty consistent nationally.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It doesn't stand out when you look at the data nationally. It's right. As you sort of hit that adolescent dip and students are you know, beginning to develop some of their independence and autonomy and sort of push back at some of the norms and rules and distance themselves and separate a bit from parents. That's a pretty consistent picture of what we see nationally. So again, we highlighted things, you know, last year that were of particular concern at the middle school, and I know Mike has been working with his faculty around some of the themes this year, but it doesn't stand out when you look across picture.
Right, exactly. Yeah, the parents and kids had sort of a common flattening there, and I know that provokes conversation for you all, and I appreciate that, but I'd love to, you know, when you've had a chance to really drill in, to let us know some of the themes that you guys have seen now a couple years in a row and what response there might be to it. I'd like to see from parents at least a consistent message across the district. I think that would be a good goal for us, so.
John, to do that.
Sure. So I recall from last year's survey, I think, that there was that challenge piece where parents said that they didn't feel their child was necessarily challenged to his or her fullest potential was contrasted a bit by some high levels of student-reported stress. And I can't remember whether I'm recalling that stress piece from this specific survey from last year or whether that information was from other reports of student stress, but so was it from this, and did you do any analysis of how, I know 2 years isn't a lot of data to, you know, assess trends, but was there anything unfavorable that fell off this year, or unfavorable last year that fell off this year, or favorable this year that fell off, that last year that fell off this year?
I would say, well, first of all, this particular survey doesn't assess stress. The Maine Integrated Youth Health Survey gets at some of that. We as a district have been talking about the issue of student stress over the last 3 to 4 years as we worked on the mission, vision, and values, because that was a large part of the information that we received both from students, well, from students, parents, and faculty when we did some of our original sort of stakeholder input sessions as we were developing the vision and mission. But I would say in response to the second part of that question, did we see particular things that sort of fell off this year that were stronger last year? Not yet. There weren't significant differences in, something that maybe was a 10 point above percentage last year might have only been an 8 or 9 point percentage difference this year, but I wouldn't say fell off, and because it really isn't within that margin of error, as Joe mentioned earlier. So they were still fairly consistent overall in the scores.
And when I say fall off, I don't mean to suggest that the problem, we would consider the problem solved, if that's what it was, but I just wanted to make sure it was still would still be on our mind.
Absolutely.
Okay. I also looked at the middle school piece, and I wondered about the fifth graders. There's a transition, it brought big transitions to me that I saw the fifth grade class definitely had low scores, and then the eighth grade class as well. And what I read as, we've got young kids coming from a very protective setting in Pond Cove, then going to middle school, and there's a shift there. And then eighth grade, big kids on campus, parents have more anxiety, and they have more anxiety going to high school, and there's a shift, which brought me to our work with transitions. And I'm sorry, I didn't bring it up earlier as an agenda item, so I just wanted to state it. How are we doing on our transition work in our helping students and parents move through, you know, those big emotional changes, fourth grade to fifth grade, and then, of course, high school?
I think there have been good efforts to strengthen it. Does that make it any less anxiety provoking? Not entirely. I was chatting with Annamika sort of earlier, who was saying, I get my tour of the middle school tomorrow, and you know, her sister, who's a little bit younger, you know, when I said, it'll be great to have your sister already know the middle school when you go, won't it? And she gave me a big smile and a nod, because it is a change. You know, this is where you've been for most of our kids, 5 years, and you're now making you know, that step up where the older students are who have a different bus schedule, you're starting your day earlier, you're going to have more than one teacher who you see for parts of your day. So there's a lot of change, and the other piece that changes, as we hear very often from parents, is that the parents who've been, you know, chaperoning a lot of field trips or coming in and supporting at center time or literacy time or doing small group work with kids, that happens less in the middle school setting. And so parents are feeling a distancing at the same time that students are feeling a distancing. That said, I think the middle school has made great efforts to really try to bring parents in and help them feel welcome. There's a lot of conversation with the Parents Association about what that looks like. Mike has held sort of fourth grade, or not sort of, but has held fourth grade parent nights.
Sort of.
They really are fourth grade parent nights, so he has held those. The Kelly and Mike have worked really closely around sort of thinking through what should transition look like, how do we do step up, when are the tours scheduled, good communication around sort of the academic transition, and with the support of Ruth Ellen, conversations between fourth and fifth grade teachers, which hadn't happened consistently, you know, over periods of time in this district through no one's fault, just the way that schedules work and things align and priorities shift, has sort of come back into place. And so have we solved it all? No.
That's great.
But I think we're working.
That's great.
So my overall observations, the basis of what I do for work is depending on community surveys to measure our progress in order to implement a strategic plan that has happened in a community. And I review this year's and last year's survey not as a measure of our work or success, but as the baseline and then a verification of that baseline of the work that's yet to be put in front of us. I personally look at some of the negativity responses of as you have very eloquently posted, areas of opportunity, because there's no way that we can grow until we embrace what it is that we need to improve upon. And the fact that there's been consistent responses in the areas in which we've done really well and areas in where we're showing need to show improvement, I think that then that those align with the areas within our strategic plan, to me, verify that we got it right and we know where we need to go. And I think that we've done a lot of the heavy lifting by pointing our ships in the right direction. So I applaud the work that's been done with the building of the strategic plan before us and all those who've put hours and hundreds of hours into that plan, as well as the effort of the parents and the administrators and the teachers that have gone into helping implement that plan step by step. John, I mean, I'm sorry, David.
No, I look like John, but
Rick,
a bit older.
Harry, you guys over there.
I have a little bit of concern with trying to judge our pluses or our minuses based on an opinion survey. To me, that's notoriously the weakest form of evidence you can think of. It depends on how educated people are, it depends on how they feel like when they fill it out, it depends on tons of stuff. I like the fact we're trying to analyze it not in terms, I guess I have a problem with saying, okay, we're great because it's 80%. Or I wonder, well, why do people, 20% think it's not great? Or we have 20% people with a problem, well, okay, but I bet that might be a difficult area for a lot of people. I like the fact that we compare it to national to give us some strength of the relative, but I'm a little bit leery of national because national includes large inner cities, it includes poor areas, rich areas. I don't know if this survey data can be compared, for example, to...
Yes. There's... I'm answering your question because I know where it's going, but yes, you can compare to small districts of
that's
roughly
exactly
our size that are not in urban areas, and that breakdown is part of the data. There are many, many, many layers of data, and I'm trying to be succinct, but yes, you can look at it in terms of roughly comparable districts.
For whatever it's worth, I think the most accurate way to look at opinion data is to compare it to an apple to an apple. Look at areas where people are high-performing districts with highly involved parents with all kinds of things. And if there is any validity to this, I think we should compare ourselves to like things. And it's nice that we have the data. I was wondering if we did.
So are there any more questions on the survey? I'm just cognizant of time. It's 9:30 and we have quite the lengthy agenda in front of us. I don't want to shortchange the survey,
Just a short one. And third strand being teacher engagement, is that still coming? That wasn't part of this report.
That's correct, because it wasn't administered during the January survey. As board will recall, the association had just administered a survey at that time, and then we were sort of waiting to see if we were going to get the full results of that and comments from that survey, and did not. So we had to wait till sort of the next window for the survey, and then...
Is that now or fall?
It's now.
Oh, it's now.
Yep. So we're hoping to have the survey completed by the end of next week, and hopefully most people will bear with us and fill that out. But it will be a couple of months typically before we get the results.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anything we can switch to have administrators leave, or do we need all?
No, they're in this boat with us again.
They're in the boat with us.
Okay.
Make them enjoy this as much.
I'm going to make my superintendent's report 3 minutes.
Okay. You ready? Go. Item 5G, superintendent's report.
I can't see it, so that's not good. So I will start with Sail Maine reached out to us. I found them. Sail Maine reached out to us a few weeks ago to say that they were looking for Cape Elizabeth students. If we had any who were interested in applying to take part on trips on tall ships for 1 to 2 weeks during the summer. And so they were open to middle and high school students, and we had students apply for those slots, and three students, Ali Stewart, who will be on a two-week trip on the tall ship Picton Castle. Cully Richard from the high school and Peter Danino from the middle school will be able to have a one-week trip on the Oliver Hazard Perry. Mm-hmm. And so that's an exciting opportunity for those students this summer, and we appreciate Sail Maine contacting us to help our students take part in that. In your packet was the Maine DOE Office of Special Services General Supervision System Monitoring Process Report.
Wow. Must be important because it has a tall title.
So the federal law requires that states who receive entitlement funds for special education monitor how districts are complying with the laws regarding special education, and we are recognized as meeting requirements by the state, so that is a good thing. There were two areas, which is a pretty low number, that were identified as areas where fixes were needed as not meeting the compliance percentage requirements, and those corrections were made.
I noticed those were the same two areas in the previous report. Am I making that up? Okay,
possibly.
You need to stay within your 3 minutes. I'm
possibly.
Sorry, I digress.
I will have to research that for you off the top of my head. But the feedback from the state essentially was this is one of the greatest responses that they had seen. And so I want to just acknowledge the work of folks in the special education department, because there's a lot of paperwork. For those of you who have not had the pleasure, there's a lot of paperwork involved in it, and it's more than paperwork. As you know, the job is really about meeting the needs of students, but the paperwork burden that's attached to that is rather cumbersome. And so I appreciate the good work of folks to make sure that piece is done.
We appreciate that too.
Peter Esposito, our food service director, and I have been in conversation with folks in the Scarborough School District about sharing his services. And so we are looking to move forward with that. Peter would essentially be the food service director for both Cape Elizabeth and Scarborough. Scarborough and Cape Elizabeth would share his salary and benefits, with Scarborough taking a lion's share of that, a 60-40 split. There are a number of benefits from our perspective to this. One is a projected savings for purchasing, and not just a projected savings for purchasing, because right now we participate in a food co-op, but one of the challenges that we have experienced with the co-op is that the co-op, due to the nature and the range of school districts who participate with them, is often purchasing some pre-processed foods, and while we try not to do that, we then often wind up having to buy some of those other products more independently. And Scarborough's values for food service are pretty well aligned with ours, and so we feel that's a good opportunity for us to sort of increase our purchasing power, essentially tripling our purchasing power and being able to buy more fresh, non-processed, not pre-processed ingredients. There's also a great opportunity for us in sort of shared training opportunity for staff across both districts, including, you know, sharing facility for use of training, greater opportunity for us to work with local farms in both in Scarborough and Cape Elizabeth and bringing in local produce. As you know, we've done that here locally, but again, greater volume and variety. We hope that will open up for us. Scarborough, you heard Declan, I think, talk about Mrs. Badinger's garden bed earlier this evening. Principal Seifries, I should say, speak earlier about Mrs. Badinger's garden bed, but that's a shared value with Scarborough as well, and so they have a couple of master gardeners, as I understand, on their faculty and are a little bit ahead of us in terms of gardening curricula. And connecting that with sort of the science education piece in their classroom. So we think there are some things we can learn from them there, as well as sort of sharing Peter's knowledge and expertise and the work that he's done with students in our schools during the school year as well as during the summer. And I guess I would say, you know, there's also a cost savings benefit to us in terms of salary and benefits, which we're projecting will be in the range of $15,000 to $20,000 in the short term. But the other benefit from my perspective is we have a very strong food service director who I think has done good work for us as a district in really focusing on what are healthy options for our kids, how are we sort of using local resources and produce to the best of our ability. And you know, as a small district, we can't compete with some larger districts in terms of salary and benefits. And when you have a strong person like that, the risk of losing them increases as opportunities present themselves. So to me, that's not the driving force, but it's certainly an added benefit of this arrangement. So that just took all of my 2 minutes, but there are a couple other things I'll get to. So there's that. CEEF, as you heard Jeff announce, the high school is receiving one of those, but they awarded about $30,000 worth of grants in this last cycle, including a literary magazine at the middle school and a musical opportunity to include sort of community musical theater shared across Pond Cove and the high school.
Middle school.
Pond Cove Middle School High School or Middle School High School?
I think it's Middle School High School.
Okay. I thought it was Pond Cove, but it doesn't really matter.
Is it Pond Cove?
Graduation was a wonderful day on Sunday afternoon. If you wonder how your tax dollars are spent around education, I would encourage you to go attend a graduation ceremony because it is a great way to see the fruits of your tax dollars or to receive the fruits of your tax dollars. And
can I intervene on that?
Yes.
Speaking of the fruits of our tax dollars, our school budget has passed. Yay! Oh. 635 yes to 236 no. So I just wanted to intervene and thank you all for your incredible hard work on that process. I know I had some bumps in the road, but we got there.
Evaluation committee, you heard earlier, is still at work on and is working from 3 to 7 tomorrow, I believe, continuing our work on getting those draft plans put together. And we are still in the process of hiring a special education director and enrollment. Updates were included in your packet, but as we look to next year, current information we have for incoming fifth graders is that those numbers are 112, so where we projected they would be. Current numbers from fourth grade are now at 140, so a bit above where we had projected, and again, one of the reasons that we put in contingency funds. And kindergarten as of yesterday, it was at 89 the day before, and now it's at 92. So,
wow.
So we expect that we will be posting for anticipated 1 year elementary teachers at this point.
Well, weren't we smart to set that money aside?
Absolutely. No surprises later.
No surprises later.
No. Wow, that's impressive. Wow, moving right along. Item six, new business. 6A, may I have a motion?
I move that we approve Lisa Melanson's proposed EF tour to Italy, France, and Spain, June 21st to June 30th, 2016.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? I know that one of the concerns we had about this trip when it was initially proposed to us was that with the new school year calendar and the potential for snow days, the June 21st date is in jeopardy of overlapping with the end of school. I noticed in our packets that Lisa Melanson had included an opportunity to push that date forward, should that be the case. So for me, that helps eliminate that conflict.
So does that mean she makes that plan with Jeff at some point to decide when she's when they're going?
They would lock in their travel arrangements sometime late winter.
Okay.
Meredith, is this a school-sponsored or a school-sanctioned trip?
Yes.
I mean, these get...
Yes, this is. So okay.
This is fully umbrellaed by the school.
Correct. So she is allowed to, she holds the informational meetings at school. It's advertised and open to all students who are interested in participating. And she has to meet the requisite chaperone guidelines.
Great.
I think she does a trip like this almost every year. Pretty close. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6B.
I move we approve the nomination of new personnel for the 2015-2016 Elizabeth Murphy Lewis and Molly Kellogg. Oh, Elizabeth Murphy Lewis, social worker at the high school for a 0.5 FTE teacher, and Molly Kellogg, a gifted and talented educator for the full district, a 0.2 FTE.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6C, may I have a motion?
I move we grant the superintendent of schools the authority to hire school personnel, excluding administrative positions, which will require school board approval over the summer.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
I can just remind the board that this is typically our last meeting of the school year unless there are special circumstances and we don't meet again until late August. And so in the event of additional positions, as we just discussed, or in the event that we have a resignation, we have a need to move rather quickly in a hiring process so that we are fully staffed for the start of the school year. So in the past, the board has granted authority to the superintendent to hire teachers. Over the course of the summer, and that information is brought to the board in September so that you're informed about those decisions. We have not extended that to administrative hirings because we feel that that's an important piece for the board to be able to weigh in on. And so the special education director position, which is open, for example, is a nomination that we would expect to bring to you at some point during the summer.
Special meeting.
Request a special meeting.
Right. So that's fair warning to all of us. I think the requirement is a minimum quorum of four in order for us to be able to accept the nomination, I guess is what we do, approve the hiring of an administrative position. So I'm pretty sure out of the seven of us, we can get four corralled somewhere on a beach.
Yeah, and we certainly would let you know as far in advance
as possible. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6D, may I have a motion?
I move to approve the following job descriptions: instructional team leader at Pond Cove, organizational team leader at Pond Cove, student support team member at Pond Cove.
Second? Thank you. Discussion?
So just briefly, these were included in your packet last month. This These are new job descriptions, or sort of different job descriptions from the leadership positions that have existed at Pond Cove in the past, and that's a result of a collaborative effort with administration and faculty and association members at Pond Cove to develop a leadership structure that best meets the their needs as they perceive them moving forward. And one of the particular benefits that they see here is that instructional team leaders are going to be more closely linked to the response to intervention process, which they believe, as you heard Kelly describe earlier around math, is going to better support students in the school.
I did notice that in our packet, the cost for the 2015-2016 school year is a slight bump up from the previous 2014-2015 school year, but I was reminded that those costs were included in our collective bargaining unit for that district. So those have been already accommodated in our budget.
I would just add, I appreciate these positions evolve, and I like that we look and reflect on them every once in a while and tweak them.
It's good practice. Yeah. Any other discussion? May I have a motion? All those in favor? It's getting late. Thank you.
Six.
Michael's not here.
Michael's here.
I can still count.
Yeah.
Item 6E, may I have a motion?
I make a motion that we approve the following athletic and co-curricular staff nominations as listed in our agenda item
6E.
The district special education,
middle school, high school, Pond Cove. There's a lot of.
Can I amend that motion? Because I meant to actually point this out earlier to reflect for the 2015-2016 school year. I know it's obvious, but.
Okay, yes.
Okay. Do you accept my amendment?
Oh, I accept it.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
So again, I'll just remind the board that these positions are all, the stipends for these positions are all part of your collective bargaining agreement, and by contract we are obligated to notify teachers of their status for returning to these co-curricular and administrative positions by June 30. And so we've included all that we can in this packet for you. I will point out, just so the board is aware, that there are two employees on the Pond Cove list who are probationary employees. They'll be in their second year, and so that again is sort of an exception to the typical practice, and so I just want to make the board aware they are Amanda Marsden and Danielle Hessert, who are nominated for the instructional leader and organizational leaders in kindergarten at Pond Cove, respectively.
Question. I noticed some of them are booster funded. You mentioned in your discussion that the amount of the stipend is negotiated in the union contract. Are the boosted funded ones also part of the contract? They just happen to be paid for by boosters.
That is true. They happen to be paid for by boosters.
Good question. Any other discussion?
I see the Chuanke coordinator is to be announced. And so that, I'm sure that someone will step up, and I'm sure. That, and then the other thing I wanted to say is to please thank all administrators, thank all the staff members who go out beyond their classroom to do this work, because we know I'm very concerned about the time they spend teaching is a very difficult, time-consuming job, and to step out to do support the district and support students is exceptional, and I just wanted to thank them very much for that.
I'm sure they would all tell you they don't care for the money.
Exactly. No. There's not much money.
Not with the stipend that they're getting for this.
Yeah.
And the key building leadership roles they fill, too, just really, really important. So I agree with Kate. Yeah. Please offer our thanks, administrators, to your teams.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6F. See, we're already on page 5. May I have a motion?
Yes, I move that we approve revisions to the following school board policies. and Procedures, JIH and JIHR.
Second?
Second.
Discussion?
The versions that were originally sent out in your packet, as pointed out today, were revised in our last policy meeting slightly to clean up some inconsistencies of language. But otherwise, you have those the hard copies that you were given tonight include the most recent language. That's it.
I like the clarity in the additions that were made. So good work on the behalf of the committee and the chair.
Thank you. I had good support from my committee.
Thank you to Andrea for turning those around for my previous meeting.
Wow.
It was fast.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6G.
Yes, I move that we allow the superintendent to carry 10 unused vacation days forward into the next contract year.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion?
I'm trying. That's all I want to say. I would really like to be able to use them in the course of a year at some point. I hope that will happen. But I've made headway.
You have made headway. You've come a long way. I think the last time we approved this, it was 14 days. So just to be clear, these are the 10 unused vacation days forwarded into the next year. These are the days that you have anticipated having accumulated to date, as opposed to you've already used the days that you carried over from last year.
Correct.
Okay. Any other questions, discussion, concerns?
We just highly recommend that you use them.
I second that.
All those in favor? Thank you. May I have a motion for 6H?
I move that we would be consider how would you pronounce it? I move that we consider an action pursuant to section 14854 of Title 20A-A that the superintendent of schools be authorized after the close of the fiscal year in order to address audit-related adjustments that may be needed to transfer not more than 5% of the total appropriations for any cost center in the current fiscal year operating budget to another cost center or among other cost centers, provided that the total current fiscal year operating budget should now be increased by such transfers.
Shall not be increased.
Not be increased by such transfers.
Key word there.
Second?
A second.
Thank you. Discussion?
So to, again, remind the board, because you only deal with this particular issue once a year, often we are able, at this point in June, to sort of identify where there might be some category transfers needed, and we sometimes ask you to directly approve those category transfers at the time of the June business meeting. As you know, our business administrator is currently out with a medical issue, and so we couldn't provide you that information in advance, and so statute provides that the board can grant that authority to the superintendent, and so we'll be working to make sure that we've identified that. And essentially, voters approve a bottom-line budget, but we report our budget to the state in terms of categories. And so if there's a movement of more than 5% between those categories, the board has to have given the authority to transfer those funds, and the state looks for basically evidence in the form of minutes of this meeting or minutes of an actual transfer decision made by the board that authorization has been granted.
Of not more than 5%?
Not more than 5%.
I know without Scott here this is probably an impossible question, but do you have any sense of carry forward in this budget?
We know that we believe we will hit at least our 150,000. Beyond that, we're still working through some pieces. There's some moving parts with insurance reimbursements and
It's okay. I just...
No, I appreciate the question. Believe me, it's one I'm asking every day.
I'm sure.
But I feel pretty comfortable that we will be able to carry forward at least 100,000.
Any further discussion? Questions? Concerns? All those in favor? 6H. Thank you. On to item 7, committee reports. Given the hour, maybe some just top-line reports. Policy committee seems to be humming right along, having just approved a couple of your policy changes. Is there any other committee report out? Sure, Barbara.
I would like to just take a moment and bring folks who may still be listening or watch this later up to date. The Cape Education Foundation Board met last night to put final touches on a really important fundraiser that's happening this week, which is the Prout's Neck Golf Tournament. There are still room for teams if anyone is still inclined to play. But beyond that, there is an online auction happening. So anyone who wishes to bid on some terrific items that have been donated to CEEF can go on their website. The link is now live. You can register as a bidder and take a look at gift cards and services and so forth. And I highly encourage anybody to do that to get the bidding going. If anyone's so inclined, if they head over to Prout's Clubhouse around 2:30 Thursday, you can do it live. But I offered to do that as an online and on-camera announcement to try to drum up some more interest. So,
thank you.
I'll just say that the innovation team, I mentioned last month that we had made a presentation to see about the grant request. Unfortunately, we didn't get the grant funded, but we did receive some feedback on how to
try again in the fall, which we will, and I think we'll have a little bit more prep time to have a more solid presentation. So,
good work. Any other committee reports? Okay. Item 8, school board agenda requests. So I believe that we'll be taking requests for our August meeting. Are there any specific issues that we want to ensure that we hit come August, other than what we've discussed previously this evening? Yeah.
And I think typically we're also sort of outlining our workshop agendas, and so if board members have specific topics that they'd like to see addressed in workshops as we move into the fall, it would be helpful to share those ideas with board leadership or with me so that we can
calendar those out. That'd be great. Announcements of upcoming meetings, item 9. Pretty short list this time of year, I'm sure.
Well, Community Services Advisory Commission is meeting tomorrow. The Innovation Team is meeting on the 16th. There's a negotiations meeting this Thursday.
Teacher evaluation tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. When isn't there a teacher evaluation meeting? Okay. Any other?
Do we go back on full meeting workshop regular schedule August that I should plan?
Yes. We don't have a first meeting in August typically.
Not a workshop.
The workshop time, the fourth Thursday in August, is typically a regular business meeting.
Oh, okay.
For the fourth, board in lieu of a workshop.
Fourth Thursday in August.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well,
I don't even want to think about it yet.
And our first September meeting will be the 9th, the day after school starts.
So we have two meetings like a week.
Pretty much back to back.
Okay.
It teases off.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments, concerns?
Does this board tend to retreat in the summer or wait till fall?
I think it's individual retreats of happiness.
Of happiness and joy and beaches.
Namaste.
Okay, thank you.
With that, I adjourn this evening's meeting. Thank you so much for being there with us.
You got to move.
Do you want a motion? Come on, do we need one?
Yes.
Anyone second? All those in favor? Thank you. Have a lovely evening.